little bit too much material this morning up here. We are starting a new series. And we are going to start the series we're calling Sons and Daughters in Christ. And we are going to talk about identity in this message. But one of the, just a little bit of an introduction to the series, one of the things that I have seen in many years of being a pastor, and Pastor Young has seen this, and maybe you have experienced this, which is I've seen people, they get stuck in their Christian life. They get stuck in their faith life. And they get to a point where they seem to lack joy, and then they go through a period, a season. Maybe that season could be short. Maybe it'll be a few months. It could be long. It might even last a few years. Where people don't seem to find the same kind of joy. And they don't find the same excitement in knowing Jesus and following after His kingdom and His glory. And one of the things that that we see is that people don't quite fully get what it means to be who you are in your identity before God, and then what that particularly entails. And especially what one of the questions that I want ringing in your mind, I mean, how do you get at this question of like, who am I? I think everybody goes, I know who I am. Do you? Do you? Do you really know who you are? In this first message, I'm going to start this series by questioning you to see, how do you know who you are, your identity? That's what this message is about, identity and obedience. And the question I want to put before you is, you know who you are by who you obey. You know who you are by who you obey. Not just obey because you're like, oh, I'm supposed to. That kind of tells you. You know you're supposed to willingly obey and surrender and submit to someone or something. But who do you willingly obey? You want to obey this thing or this person. Who do you willingly obey? And throughout this series, as we go through message after message, I think that's the question I want ringing in your mind. Who do I obey? And then, thus, who am I? Then, thus, you'll have a sense of, what is my identity? Who am I? And I'm going to give you the answer that we want you to come to, that your deepest identity is not, I'm a husband, or I'm a man, or I'm a woman, or I'm a successful engineer, or I'm a really good father. These are all some of the different roles or the masks that we put on to try to say, this is who I am. But instead, that you would say something else. That you would ultimately come by, I am a son or a daughter of the Most High God, and He's my Father. And I can only have this identity because of what Jesus has done for me. Not because I can earn it, not because I can achieve it, not because I can grasp after this this identity, this who I get to be, but actually it's been given to me as a gift through what Jesus has done for me. And that's where we'd like you to land. And to a certain, some of you are like, well, I already know this. I mean, you know this, a lot of you, if you're a Christian, you've been a Christian for a while, you know this as a piece of doctrine, as like, it's an idea. And you know that, well, it's a true idea, and it's true of me, but do you know this through your obedience? You see what I'm saying? Do you know this through where your heart finds deeper rest and joy? Because quite frankly, here's how all our identities are made. You'll find someone or something that can tell you who you are. And in order to be who this is, it'll tell you the standards of what that fulfillment looks like. And then you'll go, I am that, I want to be that. And then you willingly obey those standards. Okay? You don't believe me? You want to be a really great basketball player? Well, you must wake up every single day and dribble to school. This is the way Magic Johnson did it. He had a ball, he put it under his arm, and then he would dribble it to school. Walk to school, dribble it to school. And then from class to class, he would dribble it from class to class. He would do it from left hand, right hand. He did this every single day, so that one day, the ball would not just be this object that he has control. It literally be like a piece of his hand. And that's how you become a great basketball player. But did anybody make him do this? Did anybody make him do this? Somewhere in himself, this is who he was, who I want to be is a great NBA basketball player. And nobody made him do this, but he willingly obeyed the standard to become this person, right? So that's the question I want to like present before you today. And then as an introduction, as a first go round into this subject, I want to talk about identity. And this passage we're looking at today, I know it's a bit of a complex passage, and actually it's quite demanding in certain ways, but there's a certain portion in here which is so brilliant and so amazing, which really I hope will unlock and challenge something in how we look at ourselves and then how you look at your life. And throughout this series, I hope it'll make you rethink and reshape, you know, like what I'm supposed to obey, but then where in my real heart do I actually really desire to obey? And what does it say about who I am? And you'll have a confrontation, hopefully, with yourself. And then ultimately, it'll help you run to Jesus. That's what we're hoping for in this series, okay? That's the intro. It's a bit of a mouthful. Today's message, identity and obedience, in three parts. We're going to talk about three approaches to identity, and those are the different parts. Part one, traditional identity by looking outward. Traditional identity looking outward. Part two, modern identity looking inward. Modern identity by looking at me. And then part three, gospel identity looking upward. Outward, part one, inward, part two, gospel identity, looking upward, which will be part three, okay? Let me get into it in this passage. Let's jump into this passage, and I specifically want to look at something that this passage is saying. Identity is a really big subject because it's one of those things that everybody thinks that they know, but actually our society has very deep problems with. I don't know who I am. And part of it is because our society has fundamentally shaped how you figure out who you are compared to the way traditional societies have done this. Traditionally, societies have done it a certain way, but I want to look at, before you know, I start unpacking that, I want to take you into this passage here, all right? Let's go to chapter 3. Let no one deceive himself. Let me pause for a moment. You know what he's saying there? You deceive yourself. When the Bible says, let no one deceive himself, you know what he's saying? We regularly, you human beings, guess what? You have a propensity, you have a tendency to deceive yourself. So let's just first, I want you to understand. That's how, when the Bible says things like this, goes on. If anyone among you thinks that he is wise in this age, let him become a fool, that he might become wise. For the wisdom of this world is folly with God. It's dumb. The wisdom, the thing that we think is so wise, is actually foolish. For it is written, he catches the wise in their craftiness, and again, the Lord knows the thoughts of the wise, that they are futile. So let no one boast in men. And then he goes on to say, all things are yours. And he talks about, you know, all the different teachers. And there's, so what's going on in this passage is there's various different teachers of the gospel, and there's like division inside the church. And some are basically saying, I'm siding with this guy, Apollos or Cephas, you know, or Paul. But he's saying, it's not like that. Really, you just belong to Christ. And then he goes on to say, how should you really regard all these different people who follow Jesus? Well, we are stewards. Now, let me unpack that word. That's not a word that we usually use, but a steward is someone who takes care of and manages something that belongs to someone else. So, I mean, a modern day example would be, you know, if you hire a financial advisor and the financial advisor gets access to your, you know, your stock account, because he's the one that can decide what can go in and, you know, what investments should come out, what investments should go in. But he doesn't own it. It's yours. It's your money. It's your account. He just has authority, which you've given him, to, you know, to work on this thing. Now, he goes on to talk about being a steward of being a servant and stewards of the mystery of God. And it is required of stewards that they be found trustworthy. Now, I want to just stop for a moment here. Some people just think, I know something about, you know, is that just a pastor's? In one sense, you know, he's talking about himself as a leader of the church. But in one sense, everybody who knows of the gospel, who knows Jesus, this is you. This is you and me. We're all, in one sense, we've known something of the mystery. There's something hidden and missing in our society from, like, how do you know God? And some people have been given this. So if you know Jesus through the gospel, you have been given something of the mysteries of God. You understand that? And now you get to know God in a whole new way, in a way that other people don't know. That there's something about the way they approach God and life that actually they think is wise, but is actually foolishness from God's perspective. But we who do know God through Jesus Christ, through the gospel, you are a steward. There's actually something, you don't get to own it. It's like a special responsibility. This thing of this knowledge of God and who we are in God, it actually belongs to Christ. But because it belongs to Christ, we get it. So do you understand what I'm saying? We get to be stewards of it. It's all his. Now let me just stop for a moment. This includes who you are. This includes who you are. This includes your identity. Now let's take a moment. Now I'm going to get into this verse here that's very important. And I think this verse is so profound. And I hope it'll be something that leads us into something that I hope that could unlock a problem, a deep problem in our culture, which is this question of identity. He goes on to say this way. It is required of stewards that they be found trustworthy, but with me it is a very small thing that I should be judged by you. It's a very small thing. I consider this this little thing that you get to judge me. Or any human court. Any human court. In fact, I don't even judge myself. I don't even judge myself. Now let's time out. That thing. Can you say that? Can you say that? Can you, like Paul, say, I consider this very small thing that you get to judge me or any human court. And by the way, there are all kinds of human courts. I mean, the one that we tend to think of is, are you on trial? Are you a criminal? And then there's a judge, and then there's a jury. But that's a court. And there's all these various different kinds of people. They get to examine the evidence and decide whether you're a worthy person or not. And if you're a bad person, you're pronounced guilty, and then they throw you in jail or something. Some type of punishment is meted out upon that person in the court. But it doesn't have to require a judge or a jury, a law, all kinds of courts. Everywhere you wake up in life, guess what? You are before a human court. Everybody else is checking you out, and they get to judge you. I mean, so let's just say, you wake up, you don't brush your teeth, you don't comb your hair or take a shower, and you wear sweats, and then you go to work. You just walked into the court, the human court of work. And if you just walk, and if you go to work like that, guess what? They will judge you. Your boss, your coworker, even the janitor, when he walks by, he's like, well, who is this guy? Does he work here? Oh, he works here. He works in that office. He's gonna judge you, and then he's gonna probably start judging your boss. And he's going to start judging your whole team. And he's going to judge the whole company. He's like, this must be a really stupid company because they hired that bad, stupid person. See, the human court. And it is an extraordinary thing that Paul would say, I consider this really little thing, how you judge me. Or any human court. Not even just how you, who know me somehow, but any human court. how they judge me. I consider that a real, can you say that? Now, some of us would like to believe that we don't care what other people think of ourselves, right? I mean, some people actually say that. I don't care what anybody thinks of me, okay? Whenever you hear somebody say that, that's a lie. And that person is, as this pastor says, deceiving themselves. Because I have yet to meet the person who does not care what the human court thinks, okay? I've yet to meet that person. I can't say that. I mean, maybe I think I can say that throughout the course of my life, I'm starting to understand what chapter 4, verse 3 means. That a person can actually say, it's a really small thing, how you judge me or a human court. But let me get into identity in a moment here. We wake up and then we're trying to always form who we are and know who we are. I want to know who I am and then be that person. I want to know who I am and I want to be that person. I mean, I'm a father of my children. And so, you know, it's me who drives them to school. It's me who pays their bills. It's me who disciplines them. It's me who takes them on daddy dates. I don't expect anybody else to do that. It's me. But that's identity. And then, guess what? If that's who I am, and then everybody knows that's who I am, guess what they do? They also judge me. Do you know that you judge me? You are my human core. So you know that I'm the father of Hudson Park. So then when you meet my son, Hudson, and then you look at the way he acts and behaves, you know what you start thinking? You're thinking like, is Pastor Susan a good dad? That's part of my identity and who I am. And this gets at what I want to talk about, the traditional or the way most human societies, when I say traditional, I mean the way most human societies have defined identity is you have a role. And that role is considered a good and honorable role. And if you fulfill that role well, then people will say you're a good person. They give you the good judgment. In other words, and the word that you know we don't really talk about so much in our culture is honor. They'll honor you. And we still do it. Ours doesn't tend to do it in this traditional kind of way. They still honor you. They'll honor you. And there are really good things about this. It's very, very practical. One is, you're not just in control of yourself. You realize that there's a kind of like something that's been given to you, like fatherhood. That's something I get to own. In one sense, it kind of belongs to the society, and then I have to serve it, and then for a period, I get to be a steward of it. Do you get it? And I'm not even talking about the mysteries of God, as Paul is talking about here. We're just talking about something like being a father. And that's a role that it's mine, and I get to have that, but in a sense, you're a steward of it. And it's very practical because it's not something that's shifting. The standards are kind of, they're not like radically changing. And the society, you know, the society moves along and you get a stable foundation by which to say, I think I'll figure out who I am and it doesn't move. That's very, very helpful. Now, there's two things, and by the way, I'm not so wise. I got this from this wonderful book, brilliant chapter on identity. It called The Problem of the Self by Timothy Keller in his new book called Making Sense of God. And one of the things he says is in identity, we're looking for kind of like two things that we're looking for. Number one, we want to know who I am, self-knowledge, right? And two, you know what we're looking for? We want self-worth. We want to know self-regard. How can I figure out if I'm a good person? How do I know I'm a good person? Do you know how the traditional person figures out if they're a good person? They're given a role by society. And then if they fulfill that role and they do it well, society tells them, not all of society is just kind of an abstract word. It's the significant people in their life that represent the voice of society. Your mom, your dad, your boss, your coach, maybe a pastor. People that you respect. So we don't just have like this some random set of people that we call society, but they represent society. They represent that voice. And if you fulfill a role that's been given to you, such as being a father, and you do that very well, then guess what they say? Then they confer upon you worth. And you believe that. So you believe that. You know, your whole life is about what you believe. And the voices that go into you, it starts shaping this sense of who you are. And then now we're getting this thing called identity. But that's the good part of the way traditional identity works. It's, we look outside of ourselves, it has a certain objectivity, it's stable, and thus if you like attach yourself to that, you're not gonna be this like crazy person that's like one day this and that. You kind of know what you're gonna be, and then you pursue that, and then the more you try to pursue that, the better you'll get, and then people will say good things about you, right? But actually, there's a downside too, and I think most of you understand already. Most of us who are in America, because we know this pathway, but we don't like it. And there's a reason why we don't like it, right? Why? Because if other people get to tell you who you are, then they can also tell you if you're failing. And we hate this idea. They can criticize you. They get to be the court. They're the judge, the jury, the executioner. I'm the executioner. That's the part that's painful. They can tell you, you stink. You're a terrible father. You're a dumb student. You stink. You can't play. You're a terrible athlete. You're supposed to be a good team member and out here, and you're supposed to pass the ball at this exact moment. And then your coach comes along, your teammates come along, and you're now supposed to fulfill this role. And then they get to tell you, you stink. That's why we lost that game. And that's why we're not going to the championship. And that's why we're going to cut you from the team next year. And then, I mean, it's crushing. It's terrible, isn't it? And there's other things. I mean, this is one of the reasons why we moderns don't like this, because it lacks freedom. That's the word we love. Because it doesn't allow us, you know, if somebody tells us this is what your role is and you have to obey it, it feels very constraining, right? You know, many of the people in this church are Haitians. The one I'll tell you my personal story. When I was a boy, my parents asked the question that all parents like to ask their kids. What do you want to be when you grow up? I said, well, I was like 6 or 7 years old. I said, I don't know. Because what the heck, who the heck do you know, right? Maybe a kid, maybe some kid won't have an answer. I mean, probably when I was 6 or 7 years old, I wanted to be an NFL running back. Does that make you laugh? I mean, that's probably, if I was really honest, but I knew that I can't say that to my dad, because he'd look at me like, what is a running back? And two, are you stupid? That's probably what he would say, right? And since I'm not too dumb, I know that that's what he would think. That's not what I would say. So again, you're already kind of like you're not even honest with yourself, and you're not being honest outside. And he asked the question, and so then you know what my parents said? You know what's a really good thing to be? You guys have any guess? You can guess, right? A doctor. That's what he said. And then he started telling me all the wonderful things that a doctor gets to be and do, and why that's such a good, you know, thing to become. And because, well, I respect and love my parents, I said, it must be good. And so I started buying into this thing, and I started telling myself I wanted to be a doctor, but did I really want to be a doctor? Not really. And then I believed I wanted to be a doctor until I was 18 and actually went to college and looked at what they actually did, and I realized I don't want to be a doctor. And then you know what happened? Then I told that to my parents, and then all hell broke loose in my family. That's what happened. Why? Because this is identity in the traditional way. I don't belong to myself. I'm not free. You know what? Because the roles that you have in traditional society is not for you. It's you are supposed to serve the wider group. In this case, my family. Especially in Asian culture, it's the family. You're not you. You don't belong to you. You belong to the family. So your role, fulfill the role, and then we honor you. You fail the role, you're like, what do you mean you want to be an NFL running back? That's dumb. No, you're going to be an accountant. That's what you're going to be. No, you're going to be a farmer. That's what you're going to be, because that's what we do. Or that's what we think we do. This is the downside of the first one. And a lot of us don't like it, and we're running away from it. Let's go to part two. Then he goes and says this, all right? This is what Paul says in the next part of the verse. It is a very small thing I should be judged by you or by any human court. I'm saying that that's the pathway of identity, the traditional way. Everybody thinks that, you mean everybody else gets to have a say if I'm a good person. But then he says this interesting thing. In fact, I do not even judge myself. Can you say that? Can you say that? That you don't judge yourself? Now, I don't know any American that can say that. Every day you're judging yourself, and probably you're the worst judge. You're probably a lot harsher than your father or your mother or your coach. I'm sure you're a lot harsher than your pastor. I'm sure you're a lot harsher than your pastor. You think, you're kind of tough, Pastor Susan. I'm like, I'm not as tough as you. So here's a strange thing. The modern identity doesn't like that someone else gets to tell them who they are and what they're supposed to be and the standards for that. So you know what we want? We chose this thing called freedom. And freedom means I get to tell myself who I am. And that sounds good, doesn't it? And there's some goodness to it. There is goodness to it because, quite frankly, I mean, if you don't want to be a doctor, I mean, if I grew up probably in Korea, I might be a doctor today, a really miserable doctor, right? Or I would have failed out, and you know, I would have failed out of medical school, and then I would maybe hate myself, and then my dad might hate me or something like that, or and then we'd all be miserable. We'd all be miserable together, okay? But like that's the traditional way if I grew up in Korea. But I grew up in America, so I'm free. I got to be free. You know what happens? Okay. You get to decide your identity upon what you like. What you like. And so if you like big, I like football, but I knew I wasn't going to be any good at football, so I wasn't going to choose that, okay? That wasn't going to be my identity. So we find something else that we like and that we love, and guess what? That thing tells us the standards of who we're going to be. So you think, I got rid of the human court, and I'm me, and I get to judge myself. Not true. Not true. Guess what? Because you think you're judging yourself. You got rid of the judge, you got rid of the lawyers, you got rid of the executioner, there's me. I'm always gonna be nice to myself, right? No, you're not. So here's a strange thing. If you allow this modern form of identity, I get to choose what I want, then you start getting really confused, and now you start getting unstable. You know why? Let me offer you some problems to the modern identity. So the problem to the traditional identity is it's constraining, and you feel kind of trapped, and you're always like, and you can be judged by other people, and we hate that. Okay, that's terrible, and we already know that. The modern identity has problems. Let me offer you a few. Number one, it's incoherent. Okay? Great quote. This guy named Unapologetic. Why, despite everything Christianity, can still make surprising emotional sense? It's an English author, a guy named Francis Spufford, and he's actually rather rude and in your face. He's a Christian, but you know, he likes to swear and stuff like this, okay? But here's one of the things, he's trying to describe sin to a post-Christian English culture. And they don't even know what's, like, in his mind, that word sin just seems like a word that you laugh at. You know, those stupid religious people, they come up with this word that makes, you know, like, what the heck is sin? But he redefines sin into the human propensity to F things up. That's the way he describes, his definition is that. The human propensity to F things up. And he says, guess what? It's not out there, it's in us. And here's one of the things he puts it. He says, one of these days you're lying in a bath and you notice that you're 39 and that the way you're living bears scarcely any resemblance to what you think you've always wanted. Yet you got here by choice, by a long series of choices for which at any moment temporarily outbid the other things you wanted. So you're free. And since you're free, you always got to choose. And then you always chose what you wanted because you're free and you're the master of your life, right? But now you're 39 years old and you're saying, well, I was free and this is kind of where I ended up when I was in my freedom. And goes, and as the water cools and the light of Saturday morning in summer ripples heartlessly on the bathroom ceiling, you glimpse an unflattering vision of yourself as a being whose wants make no sense. They don't harmonize. You have desires deep down that are discordantly arranged so that you truly want to possess and you truly want not to possess at the same time. It's like you want, I mean, if you're young, you may not know this is true of you. When you grow older, you're gonna find out that you want something and not want something at the same time. It's like, I want to have sex with that woman at work, but I don't want to have sex with that woman at work because I'm a husband and I'm supposed to be faithful to my wife. And you're gonna realize both those desires in you are real. I want to be a good father and play catch with my son, but he's annoying and he doesn't throw the ball very well and I just get angry at him when he throws the ball badly and I'd rather watch football anyway. You will find those things are both true inside of you. So where are you? Who are you? You're equipped, you realize, for farce. Your life, when you're in control, is actually set up for farce, or maybe tragedy, more than for happy endings. And thus, the human propensity to F things up dawns on you. You have indeed F things up, because of course you are. You're human. Identity, when you're in control, it's incoherent. Why? Because it's based on desires, and the desires are conflicting, and they're all inside of you, and thus your identity is unstable. You don't even know who you are. At least the traditional way your identity can be stable. Now we're not even stable. By the way, I would like to propose this is one of the reasons why so many people are emotionally, mentally unstable in our society. Because the modern path to identity makes them unstable, makes us unstable. Let me offer you a second problem. Second problem is, I said at the beginning that we want to know who we are, self-knowledge, but we also want to know that we're good. We want to be able to validate ourselves. Now, in the traditional way, you go into the human court, and the human court, the jury and the judge might say that you're good. They might say that you're good. I mean, we love Magic Johnson. Who doesn't love Magic Johnson? Some of you have never even watched him play, but you know he's great. We love Magic Johnson. He fulfilled his role, and now all the human court comes down upon him, at least as a basketball player. And now we like to think he's a really good human being too, but we have no idea if he's a good father, husband, all these other things. But at least because he was so great as a basketball player, he has received the validation, the self-worth. We want the blessing, and in the old way, the other people would tell us, and then we would believe them. But now here's the problem. In the modern way, you know who gets to be the judge, jury, executioner? You! You get to be the judge, jury, and executioner. So actually in your life, there's two yous going on all the time. In the modern American way of doing identity, there's a you, it's kind of an unstable you, because there's two of them. Do you realize that you're always dealing with two yous? There's the one that you call the me. And that's the me that's the actor that's going out every day. I'm gonna try to be good at my career, or I'm gonna be a really good student, I'm gonna be really smart, or I'm gonna be really good looking and the ladies will like me. And these are all the various different desires you have going on, making you unstable, and some of them are really important to you, and then that's one person, that's the me. But then there's another person that's you, that's judge. See, there's no getting away from the court. There's you as judge. There's you as the actor throughout life. And now there's this other being. There's you as judge. So then, you guys know what this is like. You go out for dinner, and then there's like a number of different people in a social situation. And you want to say that really clever thing that will impress your boss. Or you want to say that really clever thing that will make that girl that you're interested in laugh. And then you go home, And then the judge comes out. There's the you, that's the me, the actor, and he did his thing at the dinner party. And then you go home, and then the you as judge comes out and judges the me. And then he goes, no, you shouldn't have said that, because you were stupid. That was stupid. Why'd you say that? That's what happens. But Paul can say, I don't even judge myself. Oh my goodness. Wouldn't that be great if the you, who's judge, would be quiet? Would be quiet? If you ask me, that's real freedom. That's real freedom. That'd be real freedom. Not the freedom that we think that we don't have to answer anybody else, but the freedom for us not even to be judged by that person. Yesterday in our Seekers dinner, I shared a portion out of this remarkable commencement address written by this famous author named David Foster Wallace, right? And David Foster Wallace gave this commencement address at Kenyon College back in 2005, and this thing is famous. It's like you can go on YouTube and find it, and it's been hit many, many times. And some people actually, they put that book, and then some people want to make a movie out of this. I mean, it's amazing. Do you realize I don't know if you guys understand this, but a commencement speech is a sermon. It's a kind of secular version of a sermon. You're at this important place in your life, you're graduating from college, and then this wise person come to you and give you a sermon how you're supposed to be. That's basically what a commencement speech is. It's not a pastor, but he's... So they got a wise guy from our culture, best-selling brilliant author, David Foster Wallace, and he is brilliant. And he put the screws to these young people. He gave it to them in a kind of raw thing. And one of the things he said is this, listen to this. And it relates to this question of identity and who gets to tell you what you are, but you think it's you. He realizes it's not you. Whatever it is that you value and you think is important, that thing has the standards. You think it's you giving you your own critique, but that you, that judge, is obeying some other standard. And he's a really harsh, mean judge. Listen. Here's something else that's weird but true, according to David Foster Wallace. In the day-to-day trenches of adult life, there's actually no such thing as atheism. There's no such thing as not worshiping. Everybody worships. The only choice we get is what to worship. And the compelling reason for maybe choosing some sort of God or spiritual type of thing to worship, like whether it be JC or Allah or Yahweh or the Wiccan Mother Goddess, but Wiccan Mother Goddess, that's like a witchcraft stuff, okay, by the way, if you don't know. Or the Four Noble Truths, Buddhism, or some inviolable set of ethical principles, and lots of people have those. The reason why you choose that is that pretty much anything else you worship will eat you alive. Here's something that David Foster Wallace knows, though he's not even a Christian. He knows that if you think you're gonna make identity and you get to be the only person to tell you who you are, that person must turn to something else and worship something, and that worship is the standards by which you will judge yourself. And according to him, it'll eat you alive. If you worship money and things, if they are where you tap real meaning in life, then you will never have enough, never feel that you have enough. It's the truth. Worship your body and beauty and sexual lure, and you will always feel ugly. And when time and age start showing, you will die a million deaths before they finally plant you. On one level, we all know this stuff. It's been codified as myths, proverbs, cliches, epigrams, and parables. It's the skeleton of every great story. Why? Because this is human life. Worship power, you will end up feeling weak and afraid, and you will need ever more power over others to numb you to get to your own fear. So you ever wonder why you have that boss who's like this nasty little tyrant? Because they love being that person who's in the boss. And they get off on feeling the boss because this is their identity. I'm somebody because I get to order somebody else around, and so they love ordering you around and making you do even ridiculous things that don't even need to be done because because they like power. Worship your intellect, being seen as smart, you end up feeling stupid, a fraud, always on the verge of being found out. But the insidious things about these forms of worship is not that they're evil or sinful. Actually, he's wrong, and it is evil and sinful. But that it's unconscious. We're just doing it. We're practicing worship and actually enslavement. So we think we're free. We use this word freedom. I'm free because I don't have to answer anybody else. But actually, to that hideous judge called you, he's eating us alive. All right, let's go to part three. The good news. A lot of you are doing some combination. Most of us are doing some combinations. You know, Asian Americans, you know what we're doing? We're trying to do both. We're trying to do the traditional identity, and we're trying to do like, we're like so confused. We'll do traditional identity with our parents, and then we're me. I'm American, and I'm like me. So we're oppressed both ways. Are you kidding? Here's the good news. There's a third way of doing identity. Here's the way Paul puts it. Do not pronounce judgment for time. That includes you. Don't even pronounce judgment on yourself before it's time. Before the Lord comes, who will bring light to the things hidden in the darkness and will disclose the purpose of the heart, then each of you will receive his commendation from God. From God. This is part of the foolishness. The world has a wisdom. You can call it traditional wisdom. The Asians love traditional wisdom. They love sticking all the duties on you, and then they even like to like criticize you and say, this will help you. The criticism will help you, okay? I mean, that's like kind of the Asian way. We love you by criticizing you and telling you how bad you are, okay, so that you can get better. It's always about getting better. It's this treadmill about getting better. But actually, you come to the American way, and it's not any different. It's just that the person who's like always criticizing is you. You have some voice of like a coach telling you weren't good enough, and so that you wake up every day like a crazy person. I mean, how do you think you get great in the NFL? You have that. But then what if you just fail the NFL and I got nothing better to do? But what if there was a different voice and a different judge, and he was kind and he was forgiving? You're like, but I really, really failed his standards. Yes. But he has the power to wash those failings and forgive those failings. And when he talks with you, and many of us don't believe this. This is one of the things that we're going to walk through in this series. When we believe this and let God, we always think that God is harsh. But that just means if you talk to your Lord and you think your Lord is Jesus and you think his voice is just harsh, you're not probably talking to him. You read the Bible? You notice the way Jesus talks to lepers? Maybe he's tough on you if you're being a Pharisee. But if you come and says, I've already failed in so many different ways. Actually, that's not the voice you get. And then he'll say something new. I'll show you how to be a son or a daughter like me. And I'm a son of the Most High God, and I have deep, tremendous joy because it's my identity. The son obeys the father. And let me teach you and show you how you can obey too. And that obedience will not be this crushing, guilt-riding obligation where you have to earn your identity and earn your validation and your blessing and your self-worth. Instead, he gives it to you by grace. This is the foolish pathway of the gospel to offer you a whole new identity. And it comes only when you're not alone in yourself. Like you, the crazy schizophrenic, the you who is the judge, chopping down on the you who is the falling down, failing person that's the me. Instead, God, we couldn't see him, and he's the Father, and like, but so God sent his son Jesus. So Jesus can show us a whole new way toward obedience. And he can offer us grace and power and goodness. as we struggle through this thing of identity. And he can confer us upon a new identity. And so many of us, you know, we receive this, but then we don't receive it. We receive it, and then we don't believe it. And maybe throughout these next number of weeks, you would ask the Lord, help me really receive this. And help me run to the obedience, which is my liberation, which is my real freedom. That even when I sometimes fail to obey, this Jesus never leaves me. And because of him, the Father never stops loving me. And indeed, he helps me obey. And he helps me to become who I really am. And I'll never lose his commendation, his blessing. Let's pray. The traditional way, I mean, a modern way. It's the way we find worth, righteousness. Give me the rules and I'll just, but then we get so exhausted. And there's so many people I've met, including, well, oftentimes me, Lord. And especially among people who come from Asian American background, they're exhausted people. Feeling crushed by the traditional expectations of identity. And then even more feeling crushed by their own. And yet we need a whole new identity and a whole new Lord. And instead of looking outward or looking inward, may we look upward to you, Lord Jesus. And ultimately, that you take us to a Father. A Father who is ever so gentle and ever so wise, and who loves each and every one of us with a perfect love and wisdom. And when you call us to obey, it's never just for any arbitrary thing. It's only unto our liberation and our blessing to be this beautiful son or daughter that you see in us, Father, that you've given to us only by the utter safety and the utter security of Jesus. We thank you for this gift. Help us receive this gift. Help us believe this gift. And thus, over the next few weeks, would you unleash our hearts to trust you so deeply we would obey you more than any coach that we trust or any teacher. We would, well, far better than dribbling a basketball every day, we would do the strangest things that you call us to do, because we know deep down only in you and your love for us and this relationship of being your sons and daughters can we find the deepest fulfillment and liberation. Help us to believe that and move toward that. We pray this in Jesus' name. Let's sing to our God and give him thanks.